the invitations, and I'll be talking today about two of the study that we have previously about the correlation between sleep and diabetes. And before we talk about those two studies, I have nothing to disclose. My objective today is I'll start with an introduction, then I'll be talking about the first study, which is the screening for sleep apnea at the outpatient setting. Then I'll be talking about the sleep apnea fitness and mortality, which is the second study that we did. Then I will conclude with the study. So as an introduction, so sleep apnea is a disease that is commonly recognized recently in a lot of patients, especially with diabetes, that resemble the repetitive obstruction of the airway that led to hypoxia and sleep fragmentation. OSA is obstructive sleep apnea, so I'll be using throughout the presentations. We could use a metric measure to kind of define patient who does have sleep apnea by doing the overnight polysomnography that will give us the apnea hypopnea index every hour. And since a lot of us were not a sleep medicine specialist, so I'll just have those slides. So everyone can have up to four episode per hour. But if you have five or more, that means that you have sleep apnea and that need to be treated. And they divide a bit based on the amount of the frequency that you would have to mild and moderate and severe. In this slide, I just want to show you that sleep apnea is actually more common and frequent in men compared to women, as well as it does increase with age. And the black bar is actually represent those sleep apnea related to obesity. So in this slide, our take is men have more prevalent sleep apnea than women, and it does increase with age, and weight do play a major role, but not all the role. So how common is obstructive sleep apnea? Just to convince everyone who is not convinced that sleep apnea is common, this is a study of 330 patients with type 2 diabetes who underwent overnight polysomnography. They find that almost up to 50% they have at least mild obstructive sleep apnea among those diabetic patients, and almost around 38% they have moderate to severe. So it's almost everyone has sleep apnea, and this is actually correlated with many other papers that came out. And when they divide them based on their gender, men tend to have more risk of obstructive sleep apnea, or more prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea compared to women. And when they did the multivariate analysis, they found men and those who are above the age of 65, those who are obese with a BMI more than 30, and those who report snoring, and those were carry the highest risk. Okay, so this is another study of 16,000 patients, which is a bit larger. So they divided the group based whether you have diabetes or not, and how much, what is the prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea diagnosis within that group. So an all cohort is 18%, but if you are talking only about the diabetic, it's almost 23%. They do have sleep apnea. And it just, if you look at the BMI, the higher the BMI, the more risk of obstructive sleep apnea, and if you are a male, that carry the same risk. So again, the same theory. This is a kind of versus. This is a study for those with obstructive sleep apnea, how many of those with sleep apnea do have type 2 diabetes. So this is a 213 patient without history of diabetes were evaluated with fasting blood glucose and home IR. And if you notice that the overall prevalence in the obstructive sleep apnea, 11% of those patients together, they have type 2 diabetes. And if you look, this prevalence is actually increased. The more severe obstructive sleep apnea that you do have, the more risk of the obstructive sleep apnea. And that is clear in the fasting blood glucose. Those with severe obstructive sleep apnea tend to have higher fasting blood glucose compared to those in the mild and severe and to the control. And if you look at those home IR, it's the same. Insulin resistance does get increased dramatically in those patients with severe sleep apnea. Okay. So actually, is obesity is the only cause? So are we supposed to only evaluate obesity? Although all diabetic type 2 diabetic patients, they tend to have overweight or obesity. It's actually, this relationship is independent of obesity, and in this study of 150 male without history of diabetes, home or cardiopulmonary disease, they were evaluated. All of those patients in this cohort either overweight or obese, so we're not talking about normal individual. And when they evaluated them regarding the severity, so this is no sleep apnea, mild, moderate, and severe, you kind of see the black bar, which is the postprandial reading, that is, there is a dose-dependent increment in the reading of the postprandial glucose reading. And when they adjusted for the weight, and they just looked at the sleep apnea and the glucose, those with any sort of sleep apnea, they have at least double the risk of dysglycemia. Okay, so this is how does sleep apnea do induce type 2 diabetes independent of obesity? If you look at this, it will induce hypoxia that will lead to increase in many oxidative stress, activation of inflammatory marker, and alteration in the adipokine profile, as well as in the increase in catecholamine and cortisol. All of this, either together or alone, do lead to insulin resistant and type 2 diabetes. So we don't need the overweight. Overweight to play a major role, yes, but it's not all the rule. So I hope now by everyone is convinced that sleep apnea and diabetes is some sort of something that is overlap and we need to pay attention. So now I'll discuss two studies that I have done to show you how common it is, and the other study about the fitness. So first study is simple, because I know like in our institution that I'm currently working in, we don't have a sleep lab. So what can we do for those patients? So I'll discuss this. And the second was at an institution, they have sleep lab, which I work for. So for this institution, this is a cross-section study for patient who has a regular visit to my clinic at the endocrine clinic in Taif, Saudi Arabia, which is a tertiary center, but we don't have sleep lab. So all those type 2 diabetic, whom they are adult, whom they have no psychiatric illness, and whom they have a routine visit, they don't have hypothyroidism, were included in the study. We collected the baseline characteristic laboratory finding from the electronic medical record. We also did the personal interview with one of the researchers. We excluded, as I said, anyone who has diagnosed obstructive sleep apnea or hypothyroidism or existed psychiatric illness. What we did is, there is a validated questionnaire called Berlin questionnaire, which is to screen people and to stratify them according to their risk of sleep apnea. So it doesn't tell you if this patient has sleep apnea, but does tell you if this patient is high risk of sleep apnea. And once this patient is high risk for sleep apnea, then you have to find a center to send them to do the formal sleep study to be able to proceed with treatment. So what is the Berlin questionnaire? This Berlin questionnaire is give you whether this patient is high risk or low risk, that's all. It is a very sensitive test, especially for those with a more severe sleep apnea. It's not that specific, but it's very sensitive, and that's what we need from any screening test that is available. It's very easy to go through it. It's available online. It's divided in three categories. In each category, one and two, you have to answer two questions to be a high risk. So two questions in category one and two, and one in category three will rule patient to be high risk for sleep apnea, and that has to be carefully evaluated. So we have a total of 215 patients in this study. We have fair distribution between men and women, with a mean age of 56.6. The mean BMI, so those group tend to be heavier. The mean BMI were at 31.8. Mean duration of diabetes, so long duration of diabetes of 10 years. And a majority of those patients were in insulin plus or minus oral and an oral medication. Only 5.6% were in diet control. And the mean A1C, so poorly controlled, 8.6. So, we found that almost half of the sample that we randomly selected has or reported a symptom of sleep apnea. And we divided those groups based on whether they are high risk for sleep apnea or low risk for sleep apnea. Again, those with low risk, they tend to be younger but not statistically significant. Interestingly, it's not like what we find in another study where male is more predominantly have sleep apnea. In our study, women were more tended to be in the sleep apnea group. No difference in marriage or socioeconomic status in between two groups. But those in the high risk for sleep apnea tend to be heavier. Although the other study has found that people with obstructive sleep apnea, high risk, they tend to have more glycemic control. Actually, in our study, we did not find any difference. But the systolic blood pressure were higher and significantly in the high risk group. Diastolic were non-significantly high in the high-risk group, and the heart rate as well was significant. So those with high risk for sleep apnea, they are heavier. They tend to have higher cardiovascular marker, which is include systolic and resting heart rate. So we looked at their behavior. So whether those people with high risk for obstructive sleep apnea tend to have worse behavior than those on the low risk group. And this is the sedentary life, and this is where statistically significant. So those with high risk for sleep apnea, they tend to report more sedentary lifestyle, 80% of them, compared to only 65% of those with the low risk sleep apnea. So tend to have higher cardiovascular marker, but at the same time, they tend to also have more risky behavior. And when we evaluate the risk of complications, we evaluated the neuropathy, nephropathy, and retinopathy, and one of the acute complications that is rarely seen in the HHS. So when we looked at the neuropathy, those with high risk for sleep apnea, which is the gray bar compared to the blue bar, they tend to have more statistically significant high risk for neuropathy, and HHS, hyperosmolar hypoglycemic syndrome, which is honk in the past. They tend to also have non-statistically significant high risk for nephropathy and retinopathy. So what we conclude that patient whom, the diabetic patient, whom they are high risk for obstructive sleep apnea, tend to be older and have significantly higher BMI. They tend to also to have, although their A1C is similar to the low-risk group, they tend to have higher systolic blood pressure and resting heart rate and diastolic blood pressure. And regarding the complication, those in the high-risk group for obstructive sleep apnea, they tend to have more risk of neuropathy and HHS and non-statistically significant retinopathy and nephropathy. Okay, so I'll move into the second study that we did previously to assess sleep apnea fitness and mortality. So this is a study for people with already documented obstructive sleep apnea. So those already underwent the sleep study at the lab. So we included anyone who has documented sleep apnea plus or minus plus hypertension and or type 2 diabetes. Just as an introduction, those in the recent paper that have suggested that obstructive sleep apnea not only increase complication but rather increase risk of mortality in the individual with sleep apnea. Other study has shown that fitness level or exercise capacity do inversely correlated with the risk of mortality. But really, there was a little study assessing the risk of mortality in relation to the physical fitness in those subset of patients. And that was the purpose of our study, is to assess the relationship between the fitness and this high-risk group, which have been shown to increase risk of mortality by having this disease. If you are fit, whether this alter the course of the mortality or not. So we had 567 patients whom they have documented sleep apnea with the age of 62 point, plus or minus 11. We only included those with obstructive sleep apnea diabetes and hypertension when they have exercise treadmill test between 1990 and 2010. The Veteran Affairs Medical Center in Washington, D.C. This cohort were consisted of a male only. There is no female in this group because the care is mainly provided for veterans, and most of those are male. A majority of those were African American. We divided the group based on the METs they achieved during their exercise. So how many METs they achieve, we actually divide them based on that. So we have three groups. We decided we divide them in three groups. The one, first group is the low fit group, and the moderate fit group, and the high fit group. So anyone who achieved equal or less than 5 were is in the low fit group. Anyone achieved 5 to 10 were in the moderate fit, and high fit, those who achieved more than 10. If you notice this were statistically significant difference between group, those in the high fitness group, high exercise capacity, they tend to be younger than those other two groups. But when we compare about the comorbidities and complication and even medication, there was no difference. The only difference was in the age group. So during the follow-up that we followed them up to 20 years, the mean of follow-up was 5 years, plus or minus 3. There was a total of 331 death in this group, which is considered to be 107 death per 1,000 person years follow-up. When we adjusted for age, medication, comorbidities, just to see the relationship between obstructive sleep apnea, the fitness and mortality, what we find is, what we found is those in the gray, blue, and yellow, low fitness, moderate fitness, high fitness. And this is the percent of mortality. So the low fit group tend to have higher risk of mortality compared to the moderate and to the high fit group. And for each one increase in the METs can be achieved by this patient, the mortality risk will be 13% less. And when we compare the low fit to moderate and high fit group, those in the moderate fit group, they tend to have 35% less risk of dying compared to the low fit group. And those in the high fit group, they tend to have 45% less risk of death compared to the low fit group. So what we conclude in the study, those patients with obstructive sleep apnea, documented hypertension and or type 2 diabetes, have increased risk of mortality. Well, we found that for each one METs increase in the fitness capacity, that we will be able to reduce mortality by 13%. So my take-home message that we could screen patients in the clinic and we could identify those patients whether they have risk or low risk. At the second time, we always do exercise treadmill test to screen for cardiovascular disease. We always do that in clinical practice. But have we ever discussed with our patient the important prognostic important factor of this exercise treadmill test? I think we should introduce to the patient the idea that when you increase your fitness, you actually reduce your mortality. We should not only focus on the prescribed medication, but I think there is many things that can be achieved with increased fitness. With that, I hope you guys are not asleep. I don't think those people have sleep apnea, but rather maybe the speaker has to be changed. And with this epidemic of obesity and type 2 diabetes, and the financial crisis that everyone is suffering, I do suggest a couple face masks for both of the husband and wife. And for that, I conclude and thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much for a beautiful presentation. Any questions for Professor? This is a very important topic. I hope you have some questions. Well, I have a comment.
There is one.
Go ahead.
Hi. I'm Kosh. I'm from Australia. I'm actually an internal medicine physician, so I'm not an endocrinologist like other people in the room.
That's good.
Just two questions. With the first study, you said the Berlin questionnaire is actually to high risk patients for OSA. The sensitivity is only 80%. You would want a higher sensitivity, higher than 80% for a screening test. My other question was, what about for mild to moderate obstructive sleep apnea? What's the sensitivity for the Berling questionnaire for that?
Okay. Thank you for that question. So, first of all, yeah, I do agree with you. The better the test sensitivity, the more will be optimized for the screening test. A Berling questionnaire is actually the sensitivity depend on the severity of the disease. So the more severe the disease you have, the more sensitive the screening test is. And the less severe the disease you have, the less sensitive test that we have. So when I was in the state, we have a sleep lab, so we don't have to document this. It's already been known. But when I moved back home, it was maybe new for the people who were practicing. There was a lot of physicians who were opposing the idea of sleep apnea. So I have to do something that may be simple and achievable to show them that even those were considered on paper high risk, they have not only high risk for dysglycemia, but rather for high risk for the cardiovascular marker. We have the lipid banner, but I do not put it in the slide, but they tend to have worse lipid control, although their glycemic A1C is about the same. They just kind of convince people, although just recently there was a Canadian group that they came up with a questionnaire that are more sensitive than Berlin, and it's only 6 steps, which is shorter and more sensitive, called a stop bargaining, I think. So this is, I think, it will be more affordable for physician, it will take less time, and it's more sensitive, and if you are interested, you could look at their paper that published last week. So now we have more sensitive and shorter tests than Berlin questionnaire, but Berlin is still useful in this situation where you have no sleep lab.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, oh, definitely. So he's asking whether there's any correlation between OSA and hypertension. There is a connection between both conditions. People with hypertension, they tend to have high risk of sleep apnea, and vice versa. People with OSA, they tend to have high risk for developing hypertension. If we could put it together, the diabetic or hypertension or OSA, once you have any of those, you should look for the others. It's very common. In some paper, they're proposing that almost 84% of those with any metabolic phenomena, they tend to have obstructive sleep apnea. But unfortunately, it's undiagnosed. We did a study, but I did not put the data here, about the risk of retinopathy, the severity of retinopathy, whether you have non-proliferative or proliferative. And what we find in that study, that there was really increased risk of retinopathy if you have obstructive sleep apnea, but does not change the severity of the disease. So sleep apnea is more broad than even hypertension and diabetes. It's actually increased risk of complication, micro and macrovascular. And clinicians should at least screen those patients. What we have done in some of our patients is to start them without any formal sleep study to put them on the CPAP and BiPAP to treat the sleep apnea. But I think more optimal to have formal sleep study before you initiate any sort of treatment.